Welcome back everyone to game number two here between Team Empire and Power Rangers. Game number one was a slaughter fest. We had like 50 kills in 25-30 minutes, so it's just absolutely nuts. But let's head over to game number two to see if it's going to be similar, and welcome in Blaze, my co-caster, once again. How you doing?
Doing well, man. That was a really fun game one. Obviously, a lot of action from both sides. A little clowny. I mean, there were plenty of deaths that didn't need to happen. If they go back and analyze the replay, they can try to cut down on, okay, this person shouldn't have been here. This person shouldn't have been diving towers constantly, that kind of stuff. But no, it just makes it enjoyable. Like, a lot of activity, and I really just didn't suspect it would be that involved so quickly. But yeah, we'll see what is in store for Game 2 here to round out this two-game series. But as it stands, it is still going to be the Troll Ban taking care of that hero. We'll see what hero Dittyra wants to play. Probably in Phase 2, though, that PA was the last pick.
Yeah, I'm looking at this thinking now, okay, Team Empire, they've first picked Wisp. They love their tiny Wisp. They absolutely love it. But we've been seeing the rise of Chaos Knight. And it all started with, I think it was NIP over in Major All-Stars. I know that Signature Trust, the Thai team, were doing it around the same time in Southeast Asia, where CK Wisp is starting to come back into fashion. Alliance even did it, was it yesterday, the day before? Yesterday against Secret. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if Empire are going to catch on and go for that themselves, or just fall back on the old favorite.
Yeah, I mean, no matter what, Bristleback's good too. I mean, it's just like whatever really works for you, I guess. But the Disruptor is going to cause some issues here with the Glimpse, making it so that you can't guaranteed relocate both people in there. You're either going to be caught in the kinetic static, and that's going to be capitalizing the fact that you're both stuck in that identical position with the relocate, or they can glimpse one out and isolate somebody. But Tiny, the classic, is going to be coming through, and I think that's more just because he has so much raw HP to work with. Like, he is a very beefy hero. He builds Aghanims. He's going to be able to survive through the magic damage they put forward so far.
Yeah, and he's kind of a natural BKB carrier. You know, with CK, you can buy BKB, but it sort of halts your progression of stat items through Armlet, Heart, Sand and Yasha, whatever you want to go for, into Manta Style, and later on the big old items. But with the Tiny, you can go BKB. Disruptors, Aghanims, we might see that prioritized pretty heavily, because PR, we've definitely seen them in last game, give Jotun the heavy five roll where you're running around with wards and sentries, while J4, if he has his hands on his Disruptor, a quick Aghanims is more likely than not going to be on the cards.
Yeah, and along with that, honestly, there's the option of just BKBing right before the relocate connects. As long as you tether before the BKB is active, you can still relocate the person. So I usually see if you're up against something like that, that you're just going to BKB the very last second before the relocate puts you in the fight. So it's hard to say, but I think that's probably more likely than not. Mm-hmm. The Storm, the Puck, going to be the bans out here. So are we seeing a Lightning Draft? We're going to see Razor coming out. I don't know. Bristleback is not really Lightning oriented unless he builds three Maelstroms. So hopefully we see that.
Only three?
Yeah. I mean, you got to have, you know, TP Scroll. It's important.
You've got to have a TP Scroll, some boots for the Bristleback. You got to go quick. But third pick here for Empire. Pick up your secondary support. You know, the Wisp Tiny are more likely than not going to be going towards the middle lane. On the Dire side, they have a pretty decent time for the Wisp. Getting Rune, making that rotation through the jungle, and stacking up the small camp, medium camp, large camp, whatever he wants to get his hands on for the Tiny to go and clear out. But your other lanes. Are we going to have... Actually, are Power Rangers going to run Bristle Dazzle mid and then have like an offlane Zeus and then disrupt a safe lane with someone? Because that's definitely one of the lanes I've seen quite a lot against the Tiny Wisp, just to stop them completely early on in the game.
I haven't seen Bristle Dazzle since pub, so I'd like to see it in a competitive sense, but it does feel like a bit of a pub draft to me. It's when enemies underrate your damage and don't expect that, like, they're going to get hit by physical damage via Shadow Wave or Quill Spray hurts after it's stacked up three times, that kind of stuff. Io Tiny is really low in armor naturally, but you also are going to be fueling a lot of magic stick charges for the Io. He might not go for the same item build, but as long as he plays back, he should still be able to keep that Tiny healed up with that magic stick. So I don't know. I think it's a cool idea, but I don't consider it ideal in the sense that they still need to address the Tiny in the fights. They need to kill off the Io, Skywrath, who are both very high priority targets in their own rights. Io is because he's the battle medic. If you focus anybody but him, he's just going to heal that person. And Skywrath, because he's a glass cannon that, as the fight goes on, as long as he has mana, is putting out more and more magical damage. So these heroes are squishy. They need something to focus that down, and picking up Date Yoraz Phantom Assassin is going to be that way to do so.
Well, the PA is the pickup there from Power Rangers. Safe lane PA can jump onto the IO, like you were saying, focus them down in teamfights, but she needs to get those items flowing first. So they need to give her a really safe lane to farm up for the first 15 or 20 minutes. I don't really see them fighting that early. Zeus should be okay on that mid lane if that's where he does go. Bristleback on the off lane should be having a decent time. But PR right now, it doesn't feel they've got enough to get up in the faces of Tiny Wisp to stop them before that 15-minute mark. Because we're looking at like a 15-minute Agnims right here, where Tiny goes into the jungle, takes down camps and stacks, and PR don't have the tools at their disposal to go in and stop that.
Yeah, I think the farm from Tiny is going to be pretty insane here. He's definitely going to be top of the net worth. There's nothing really to shut him down. And now the Brewmaster is going to make space for them in the team fights. Because although PA would just like to go fully into damage here, the Brewmaster is going to have that Drunken Haze. You have to pick up a defensive item to deal with that. And in general, the Tornado is going to take you out of the fights too. So we're going to see a lot of very disruptive weather here. Between the Disruptor, the Zeus, the Brewmaster, there's going to be a lot of magical effects that regard the atmosphere. But no matter the case, I think PA and Bristleback are going to be hard-pressed to get items to keep pace with the Tiny. And Tiny might play this kind of like, I don't know, an Alchemist does, as far as like get big quick, get like four items really fast, and then annihilate. Just get Aegis, get towers, and if you win one fight, the racks are gone because of how the Aghanim Scepter effect works with Tiny.
Yeah, definitely. Solid has been playing a little bit of Brewmaster, but I don't know. Where do they run these lanes as Empire?
I don't like offlane Brewmaster anymore, so I would have to say that they're still looking for their offlaner.
Yeah.
And in that case, they can run the safe lane Brew, get him Blink Dagger farm, and then run the duo mid for IO Tiny.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. Then they can stack up with Scarth Mage. Brewmaster doesn't really need someone to babysit him. He's pretty self-sustaining on that lane. With the Magnus banned out, that kind of makes sense. We've seen that a little bit. It definitely reminds me of like a signature trust draft that they've run before, Team Empire, where they had this Magnus offlane that didn't do well at all. And all of a sudden, in these team fights, come in with a big RP and power up the Tiny and just smash people down.
Yeah, that'd be very scary. And the Spirit Breaker makes sense, too, because you look at Team Empire supports. They can't stop the charge. Like, you have to avalanche the charge, otherwise it connects. And that's not where you really want to be. You usually want to commit, like, a level 1 Hex or something to cancel it out. But they do get another Stunner, and it is going to be in a different role set than I think we're most familiar with. Is this going to be an offlane Sand King for Yoki?
Yoki offlane Sand King. He definitely has had quite a few fruity pickups. We've seen Lina, Rubick offlane on the dire side, and now Sand King. Well, Pudge obviously is probably one of his more famous ones, the magical Pudge offlane. But Sand King for Yoki, he'll be running down to that bottom lane and trying to get as much done as he can. Now, Power Rangers, do you think they start switching up lanes here, or they just go stock standard, surely? Zeus mid, Bristleback offlane, then defensive trial lane with the Lion Disruptor and PA.
Yeah, obviously, if they know that the Brewmaster is going to be in the safe lane, they might try to put a little bit more pressure there because it's going to be the weak point. But yeah, overall, I think that your Yoraz farm has to be prioritized. So at most, they send more supports top. It's still going to be the cores, as you mentioned it, but they might say, Jotam, help out the Bristleback. And as a result, he'll get a lot more farm than the Brewmaster. So depends on the pressure they feel bottom and if they want to pressure Silent up top.
Well, over on the Dire, Resolution will be playing that Tiny supported by Aloha Dance. Always Wanna Fly is running across with the Scarath Mage, trying to get his ward down as quickly as they can, but also contest that top bounty rune. Really important for the Wisp to get the first bounty, so he instantly has that bottle to deal with. Then you can look at stacking camps, healing up Resolution, controlling the lane like that. Silent will be playing the Brewmaster with Ring of Protection and Stout Shield, expecting that physical damage to come out from Cheshire Cat relatively early, while down in bot lane, Yoki on the Sand King. Boots first, Observe Ward ready to be placed, but Dichira is there and waiting. Scout out Yoki, the PA there, J4 playing the Disruptor, while Jotam on the line is a little bit slow to the party. Mid lane is Axmo on the Zeus.
Yeah, so the big thing here is that the Radiant Observer Ward for their top lane is going to stick there for pretty much the entire time. Like, you can de-ward in this kind of central area, but more likely you're afraid of like a ward that's a little bit deeper in this spot, so you're going to kind of hit the middle ground. You're going to go ahead and sentry there. You'll take out those two wards, but this one is going to go and just stick around, and that's going to give him the vision he needs to know when he's going offensive or not.
Yeah, definitely. It's also one of those sneaky little wards where you can, you know, run into this spot and throw it out, so you don't get scattered at all. It's not really something that the Dire has. Mm-hmm. You know, they can potentially get into this area here and place an observer ward there. Oh, stun out. Yoki trying to get the bounty rune, but he won't manage. J4 clicks first, clicks fastest. Well, top lane, Wisp does get his up at top.
Yeah, so that's the bottle for him, which is really important for this mid matchup. And it is going to be IO most likely going for a 1-0-1 build at level 2. The overcharge will allow him to just constantly spam out the bottle onto resolution. And Tiny with unlimited mana is a scary thing to behold. And he's got the magic stick too. Like, you've got your magic stick for resolution. You've got the bottle already up for Aloha Dance. Axmo is going to have a completely different landing experience than what we saw for him last game. Actually, kind of the same. He was the Void, right? So
yeah,
maybe that suppression level.
I was just watching Aloha Dance take the full brunt of the arc lightning, but Jotam in the back lines actually found the courier kill. Bottle That's wasn't fine. On it, but this means there's going to be no bottle ferrying, no sending it back and forth from the fountain. Wisp has to rely on that top rune. Luckily for him, there's no one really going to contest it. As top lane, Cheshire Cat, does he die? Salving up, he'll just be fine. He'll be just fine. He's
but it
okay.
costs him a lot. That's like a 400 damage nuke there coming from the Skywrath. And Yoki bottom, Thunderstrike will hit twice and drop him down to 14 HP. So valuable Tango there. But overall, if you are on the top lane as the Bristleback and you take that much damage, you'll be okay because you have a lot of Tangos and you have a Courier. Yoki, not so much. He's got to limp back to base because less Tangos, and he doesn't get the chance to ferry a regen to himself. So he's going to have to go all the way back. And in this case, I guess he's not missing out on that much experience because the pulls are coming
resolution.
Through so easily.
Tosses Axmo back into the creep wave with the right clicks here. Do they have enough damage? It doesn't look like they
close.
Do. They're going to dive him. They're diving him into the trees. Axmo, you took the wrong path out, man, as Resolution finds the final right click in. You know, it's one of those things. If you'd continue running down this way, could you have survived? Maybe. But running into the trees, it buys you a little more time for supports to TP in. They just weren't there.
Yeah. Disruptor's really bad at rotating at like level 1 or 2, and the Lion just, he's been occupied. He's went for the Courier Snipe. Now he's just shy of Boots, so the TP just isn't there. He's only level 1. So one more pull, and he'll be in a position where he can start rotating, but it's just wasn't there at the time. Yoki actually getting some good trades with J4, but combining that Thunderstrike with the dagger, and he's actually suppressed pretty hardcore. No Sandstorm is the key thing here.
Axmo drops Aloha Dance pretty low, and he has to walk himself back to base to fill up that bottle and head towards mid. Matt, was that Magic Stick picked up by him now? Yeah. So they've got Magic Stick on both mid heroes. They'll keep themselves pretty healthy, both mana and HP-wise. I was just looking at the levels, though. Yoki is level 1.5. Cheshire Cat is level 2.5, so he's like a full level ahead. But
yeah.
Sand King is the one that needs to hit that level 3. He's not a hero that can dip back into the jungle. He can't stack ancients for himself. He needs level 3 so he can go and take jungle stacks. And then you're also looking at the fact that Tiny wants those stacks as well.
And it's going to be a dive up top. The clap will come through, and Bristleback has 2 points in the passive early. It's actually really smart here, but it's still not going to be enough. There's just so much damage between these two heroes. The Skywrath Brewmaster duel is very scary, and even Axmo can't really contest it. He goes in. He's going to get clapped. He's probably going to get killed.
See how many crits Silent can pump out this time. He got a double crit over on the Bristleback, but the toss in from Resolution. Honk.
Jams it in.
Aloha, that's the Aloha hand grenade.
Exactly.
It's thrown across. Yoki now heading towards mid. They want another kill. They know where J4 is. They've spotted him out. Yoki heads through the trees. He's going to get vision now. Burrow Strike to start things off. No? Yes? No? He sees in the two-man Burrow Strike. They catch both. Resolution with the Avalanche Toss. This is going to be a massacre. They'll find Axmo. He does get the counter kill back onto the Sand King. Jotam now onto the tower. Hexes and stuns Resolution, but they're healing from Aloha Dance.
No. This is too much.
Toss. He's got toss off cooldown.
9 stick charges, though, so he's so confident. Just with all those stick charges, he's like, tread swap, get back up 500 HP, and keep that ball rolling. But it did look a little dicey just because, you know, that's a lot of tower hits to take. And Jotam, he's quick on his feet. But end of the day, they make some really good exchanges. 5-1 is the current kill score for Empire. And Sanky got involved in something. He actually got to level 2. It's very rare that you can hit a 2-man level 1 Burrow Strike, but he found that opportunity with a little bit of patience.
He was just standing there and I'm thinking, what's he waiting for? What is the mindset where you think, okay, there's a disruptor, I can go and stun him right now, he spotted me, but I'm gonna wait. It's just so calm and collected, and I guess that's why Yoki is definitely considered one of the best, if not the best offlaner in Europe right now. Well, definitely with his hero pool, it's pretty nuts, but just his style of play, the aggression, but also the patience at the same time is really nice to see.
Mm-hmm. So we're gonna be seeing some stacks come through finally. That's one thing that you hit on pretty expertly there, is the fact that they need the stacks for both Tiny and Sand King, and previously they had none. Like, just 2 minutes ago, they had just the single camps for across the entire jungle, and that's a big problem, but they've rectified that just now. They've gotten a lot of kill momentum. Heck, IO's gonna have an urn soon. Like, they are gonna have all the healing, sustain they need to move forward, but it's actually gonna be a bit of a snowball build from Resolution's Tiny. We're actually gonna see a kill up top there, Skywrath, bringing down the Bristleback last hit. Silent, still pretty deep, but he has the split.
Glimpse back to give a few more town hits down. Axmo, okay, they can't get it. Silent splits. Is he looking for kills or is he looking to escape? It looks like it's the former. Going in onto the Zeus, start things off with a concussive shot and bowler toss, and in comes Resolution once again. He's got the avalanche and he'll try and focus down the line, but a little bit of missynchronization there as he gets sent up into the air by the Brewmaster split, and now things turn back around a little bit. Stun out, orbs flying, and Bristleback is down, chasing Silent. One more cool spray, but in the back end, Resolution, along with the low add-ons, take out that little old lion. And again, avalanche, toss on cooldown. One more second, they don't have enough life, they can't finish him off. Cheshire can with the ultra kill, finishing off two with one cool spray right at the end there.
Oh, I just want to see this Bristleback's experience. 1380 experience from that. You look at the level, like, it's 600 experience to get from level 7 to level 8. He just gets 2.25 levels out of that exchange with a tremendous ultra kill, bouncing him back 100% from this landing phase. Just enough quill spray, enough physical damage coming out, and a bit of missed bottled micro coming in from Silent. He actually had a bottle, and there was no damage instances for 3 seconds, and then he waited until an auto attack came through and died immediately to the last quill. So that gave a lot of kill momentum. Empire overstayed their welcome, and Bristleback brings it home. They still got some good kills out of it, but they're not clearly the winners out of that one, and in fact they're actually falling a little bit behind now. Silent taking a lot of hits here, and without split he has to be worried about those support rotations.
Yeah, definitely. I wish I'd taken a look at net worth before that fight kicked off, because I'm pretty sure the Bristleback would have been sitting on like 1500. He's more likely than not doubled up in terms of net worth over the course of that one fight. Always want to fly in. Silent now up on this top lane, just holding their own. 30 seconds until split, and that's when maybe they can start looking to turn things back around onto the Bristleback, as the PA is found in her own jungle.
Yep. They don't have a lane ward there, so they're just able to
relocate top. They found Cheshire Cat, toss to start things off. Where's the stun? Where's the avalanche? Resolution has it now. Okay, coming back off cooldown from the kill down on bot lane, and they will kill off that dominating Bristleback and give the kill streak to Tiny.
And suddenly, like, the Bristleback is actually the most important kill on the map. Dominating streak and level 8. If they, like, you usually look at a mid kill, much more importantly than an offlaner, but what's he gonna do? The Zeus is barely level 5. Jotam, gonna be down to the last right click there. The tether is bugging out for me, yeah. But either way, they are gonna be turned on by Dit Yara. Not sure that's the right play, man. You don't have that much tank, and the Urn of Shadow strikes.
Ow. He blinks into the Tiny with his full combo up. The Glimpse back will save J4 for now.
Oh, he has to walk away for the spirits to do their job, but still forcing one back and getting two kills. This Tiny is just having kills handed to him on a silver platter.
Well, Yoki has hit that magical level 3 and more. He's level 5 now, taking out a couple of jungle camps. In fact, did we see who took out the big camp?
Sand King must have been working the jungle here. Yoki was farming the jungle while everybody was diving top lane.
Okay, so they give that across to Yoki, get him his blink dagger a little bit sooner than they normally would. Resolution, Aloha Dance, running between the tier 1 and tier 2 towers. They don't give a damn. Axmo now on the retreat, but he's where's he going? Has he gone the right way? Has he juked them? It doesn't look like he has. Resolution still on the hunt, but closing the gap here, he's got to toss the wisp.
But he wants to, but it's dangerous. Yeah. With the tether just being on cooldown, they'd walk right into Zeus Bristle, and Aloha Dance isn't that tanky. 800 raw HP, 1 armor, could go down pretty quick. So, yeah, they forego the offensive play, let the little fishy slip away, and are actually going to go on mid here. The Drums of Endurance popped, the Glimpse available, but the kinetic's going to be enough. Courier again?
Really? Where did this die?
It's neutral. Wait. It's neutral creeps killing it. Yoki, no. My man. It's not a.
Did he send himself a clarity or something?
Yeah, it's just like regen. Like, yeah, that's all he got out of it. Value clarity.
Oh man. So with the sandstorm, the creeps were like, huh, we can't see who's attacking us, but that piece of shit over there, that's the closest thing we have to a target, so let's kill the courier.
Yeah.
What is it? The Babka, the Bewitcher. The old grandma flying around, the little witch. Always want to fly, flying such a cat, slows him with a concussive shot, but without Silence blinked. Oh, okay. Okay, relocate in. Silent now tossed in with a clap. They'll find him. I'll get the kill on Cheshire Cat. It looked like he was fine, but all of a sudden, of course, the global presence from Resolution and Aloha announced, closing the gap there.
Yep, and J4 looking for maybe an opening on Always Want to Fly, very low HP, and they've got three. Jump again. That's the kill. Thunder God's Wrath will keep Silent out of it, and they actually get the Hex too. So Chain Stun here from Jotam, and that's going to be two key kills. Yoki can't save him.
He gets the split off and turns back around to Digiraw. Yoki is level 6, but no Epicenter. He's gone for 3-3-0-0 just to try and increase his farming speed, but also the fact he knows he's not going to have Blink while he's level 6. So split will expire, he'll run himself back as Silent is still 400 or so gold away from that Blink Dagger.
Yeah, that's the timing that he does not want, but still, I mean, the split keeps him alive. The Stag Storm coming out from Disruptor just a little bit too late, being a little bit too far back there. Bottom, Aloha Dance, oh, where's that tether? Get out of there, get to the chopper. Just get away from that porcupine, that's not where he wants to be right now. He does go for the Power Treads, which is an interesting distinction between the Arcane Boots and the Tranquils. Obviously, this one doesn't provide regen, but it allows him to get that extra durability and damage with the 8 strength providing both, since he is a strength hero. And then, of course, he gets to actually swap the treads around when he uses these restoratives so that it helps him a little bit more. And since he's commonly the focus, this is actually the best way to tank up.
Yeah. With the magic stick is the big one there when you're tread switching. You know, switch to agi treads, you pop it, get that little bit more in terms of mana and HP back, and giving it to that Tiny, who's taking a lot of damage when he's fighting up against Bristleback. The Quill Sprays and the passive do hurt quite a bit. Tiny with the treads and drums build, now heading into that Aghanim's, and 1800 gold away, 12 minutes in. He's going to be hitting this at the 15-minute mark, no problems whatsoever, really.
Yeah, but look who else is building up a pretty interesting item here. Cheshire Cat is going for the mechanism on the Bristleback. There's the bottle, magic stick, and treads to allow him to have a decent mana pool. But even with these intreads, as you can see, he's sitting at 600 mana, and without it, it's only 500. So trying to support a 250 mana active at this early stage in the game, it seems a little dicey to me. He's got to have all the magic stick charges. I guess the Brewlings do provide quite a bit in the fight, but it's not my favorite item progression unless you have something like a Wisp that provides you the mana.
Yeah, we'll see how he does with it. I think it's the fact that they know the Empire are getting to that stage where man fighting and diving towers is definitely going to be their key objective. Like right now, Empire, three heroes up on top. What is the plan from the Radiant? Do they contest? They run in here. They've got Thunder God's Wrath level 1, but Zeus is dragging behind so heavily. Zeus is behind the Sand King. Sand King, who was level 1.5, you know, 3 or 4 minutes in.
Yeah, it's been a hard game for him. He's 0-4. Expo, he had a bad Void lane, now he has had a bad Zeus lane, and it's not making a good case for his standing placement on the team, but it's still, I mean, he's doing the best he can. With one good combo, he should still be able to kind of bounce back here. The big thing is, when you're killing off level 9 heroes, then you're going to be able to get that big boost of experience. And with a global spell, you can actually KS intentionally, and that will actually give you that share of the experience. So it's nice if he can just kind of finish the job and actually get up to level 11 the timing that he needs to. Because you compare that to, I think it was Resolutions, Zeus last game where he had the Midas early. Yeah, it's definitely a different tempo, Zeus.
Most certainly. Silent's up on this top lane, hiding away in the fog with his Blink Dagger. Where's Yoki, though? Because these two heroes, I want to see them really pair up together and get the combined Blink in. Epicenter Blink is at the same time as you Blink in and clap, get the Burst Strike on a couple of people. It's going to set up perfectly for that relocate. In fact, that's a really great thing that Empire have. They've got these three heroes who can defend towers and hold their own in a team fight, giving space to the Tiny Wisps to go and farm side lanes and then relocate in whenever they want to.
And that's kind of why I was surprised that Aloha Dance and Resolution were actually up top, when that was where the fight was clearly going to be. You kind of want the heroes to be away from the fight, and then you relocate them in. But you always have to be worried about that glimpse, and if J4 is in the picture, then glimpsing one back would make that a tactical error. So instead, they kind of just spread out the map, two up top, and they should be relocating at least into the tree line soon.
Oh! God, if Finest Garth Mage start now hexed up, there's no further stun, but the Static Storm will hold them in place with the kinetic field. Resolution caught in, glimpsed back onto who, though? Who do they send back?
They sent back Sand King, actually.
Okay, I saw it happening. I was just wondering who the hell the heresy targeted on. Cheshire Cat now caught in the avalanche and toss. Silent has split, but Resolution is dropping so low. Aloha Dance comes in with the heals as Silent 1v2s. Dichira cycloned up as Cheshire Cat. They try and focus him down, but he's so damn tanky. With one more boulder toss, they finally seal the deal. Dichira, where do you go? Where do you hide? You can't run away from Resolution and Silent.
And that's just, I mean, they started the fight really well with the Skywrath pickoff. They essentially initiated a 5v4, but the Empire is just so strong right now with their chain stuns. They, even just with one Burrow Strike, Aoki makes his contribution. And then, of course, Silent with that massive Primal Split. Like, he can do so much work with that spell. So they do what they can, barely survive with Resolution, and now he's got his axe.
The best part was, though, Yoki comes in, he gets like one Burrow Strike off, then he's back down in bot lane. He's like, okay, my job's done. I stunned someone, and now I can go back to farming. So, you know, the glimpse back onto the Tiny or someone like that would have obviously have been a lot more optimal, but J4 in that panic state was like, oh crap, I've got to send someone back. I guess it's going to be the guy who just TP'd in, and Yoki was that target.
Usually it should be Tiny in that situation, but maybe he didn't realize the Sand King only had mana enough for one spell anyways, and he just took him out of the picture. But either way, they lose that fight pretty handily, and you gotta think they're in a very defensive position now. Like, the PA is building up a BKB Vlad's. Like, that's Dit-Yura's items. It's not going to be much damage coming out from him for a while. He has to build purely defensive and rely purely on crits.
Before he has that BKB, though, Burrow Strike into Mystic Flare. Do they have enough damage between them, the Sand King and Skywrath, just to kill the PA?
2 points in Ancient Seal, I would say yes. But it's close.
Well, I don't know, you switch to Strength Treads. If Dichira can switch to Strength Treads, then it's going to be even closer. And maybe he runs away with, you know, like 100 HP or something like that. Cheshire Cat running into Silent up on top, but Split is off cooldown. Silent's ready for this. Relocate in. Actually, they're more than ready. They turn things back around onto the Bristlebag. The PA comes in with a dagger onto Aloha Dance and looking for the crits. Can't land it. Setting Storm Mechanic Field completely whiffing as Yoki lands the two-man Burrow Strike and Mystic Flare. This looks like it's it for PR's fight. Dichira, the last man standing, as he's going to get nuked down and taken out by the rest of Empire.
As effective as J4's Ancient Apparition was last game, his Destructor is just not on point. It's a very powerful hero with a lot of potential, but in this case, it's not being realized. They missed the entire Kinetic Static Storm. The Glimpse play is just not happening. Like, this Disruptor is a key hero in these fights, and he's actually almost their only controller. Like, you've got Earth Spike for AoE disable, and you've got Disruptor. Other than that, they've got damage. So it's all on J4 to make these disabling plays. It's a pretty tough order for him, but it's just one that's not being fulfilled.
Yeah, you gotta look at Resolution and think, okay, he survived with that 150 HP in that fight. They couldn't actually finish him off. Because you've said they've got very limited control, but they've also got pretty limited burst damage. Zeus and Lion are the two heroes there that can get that done, but their two biggest damage dealers, really, are the PA and Bristleback, and it's slowly, over time, whittling away at this Tiny's health while he's bashing you into the ground with his big old tree stump.
And it comes back to their second pick. They were up against Zeus Disruptor, and they picked Tiny. And we were talking about the different options, and Resolution just gets to build tanky early. Tiny already has crazy good strength gain, 3.0 per level, good natural durability. And then he builds Ags and Drums and Treads. But now he's going to take some real good right clicks, and they are going to commit everything they need to bring him down.
That has got to be a misplay. The Wisp relocated out. And I'm pretty sure he wanted to take the Tiny with him, but didn't tether across. And now Aloha Dance. Excuse me?
He got glimpsed? He got glimpsed? He got...
What?
That's where you say in all chat, thank you. And you just go on with the game. Yeah, that's...
J4?
Yeah, he's having a really off disruptor game. He is going to go for the Aghanim Scepter you're talking about, at least a casual point booster, but if he's not hitting the spells in the first place, I don't see how it'll help him.
Oh, man. Like, I was talking in the last game, you know, about morale and how one team fight where one funny clowny move can really set your morale high or low. Right now, PR, they've got to be feeling pretty sorry for themselves. They kill a tiny, okay, that's a great bonus for them. They get that big kill, they stop him farming, but it's still a tiny with Aghanims and Hyperstone. He's going to run into the jungle, take down his creep camps in about 15 seconds flat. But then the glimpse back on the Wisp, you know, you hang your head in shame, you all chat, question mark, are you okay, and then you move on. You move on and you get things done.
Really hard for them to take fights, so they're going to play the farm game for now. As far as vision goes, there's one really good deep dire ward for Empire. There's a so-so one that's going to expire soon for PR. But beyond that, yeah, pretty open map. So the next wards could define where the fights take place and who's going to be able to feel safe in their own jungle.
Cheshire Cat, have you got something on the courier? No. No.
Oh, goodbye. That ward that I was just talking about. Seeing J4 place this ward here, getting the kill on him, and most likely, yeah, always want to fly just purchase sentries in reaction to that play in Namid.
Middle lane, Cheshire Cat getting ripped a new one. Resolution doesn't have Avalanche or Toss. Silence slows him down, okay. There's the gap closer. Yoki blinks in with a Burrow Strike, slows him down, and...
Do they go Rosh off of that?
I don't see why not. You were mentioning how PR can't really go into a head-on-head fight. They can't 5 versus 5 right now. How can they possibly contest Roshan? Especially with Bristle back down and not wanting to buy back.
Exactly. I mean, like, it is a pretty... Not the fastest Rosh. They have to use Overcharge just to really get Tiny hitting as fast as he needs to. But end of the day, it's a 5v4 in a situation where they'd probably win the 5v5. The only thing would be the Disruptor hitting, like, a 3-man kinetic static in that pit. And we obviously see that's not happening. So they don't even bother scouting with Thunder God's Wrath. They're probably suspicious, but they see the message pop up, and it's just another problem. They've got 100 problems out of 99.
J4? Okay, he's gonna be okay, right? He's fine. Right? He gets behind the tier 2.
That's the difference. Earn of Shadows charges. But still. Yeah, he knew that he got scouted out when he made his movement to place that ward, because he got blinked on over the tree line. So he goes ahead, takes care of the ward that was deep in their jungle. But it's kind of just a denial of vision across the board. That's two unsuccessful wards from both sides.
I was just taking a quick look at hero levels, and obviously, you know, you've got Tiny and Brewmaster up at the top with Wisp level 13. He's out-leveling the PA. Well, actually, have a look at experience. PA has just hit level 13. Wisp, yeah, he's out-leveling the PA. Then the Zeus is almost bottom of the chart. That's a really sad state for your soulmate Zeus to be so far behind.
Without a blink dagger, you're so squishy and you're so vulnerable to relocate plays. The four staff helps, but it doesn't guarantee you'll get out of there. And just dying four times, when's the last time you saw a Zeus get only one kill and two assists? Like, that just doesn't happen.
Jotum opens up with a hex, but Aloha Dance is so tanky. 1200 HP almost with the mech and urn. They're gonna turn this back around. Can they find it? Yoki with a force and blink. Burrow Strike just in range, but the blink back from Jotun saving his life. TP out now. Can they get in there? It doesn't look like it. Resolution not ready with the Avalanche, and he can't close the gap on them, so PR make their way out. Where's that concussive going? It's not going to hit anyone. It must have been aimed on the lion or something like that. It's going to hit the fountain, dissipate into the ether. As Resolution and Aloha Dance up in this top lane, tier 2 in their sights. Contest from PR, close to non-existent right now, as Cheshire Cat building into a BKB of his own.
Look at the coverage here from the Sand King. Blinking, forcing into the trees here. If there's any attempt from PR to try to contest that, they'd be rebutted hard. The Epicenter coming through, just hitting on, it would be at least a 2-man Burrow Strike. It's the perfect setup you want. And in this case, he might have to smoke for it next time. They do have smoke on Skywrath, so probably Skywrath and Sand King back off, go for a 2-man smoke, and then everybody else stays on the front line. But for now, it's just full vision for both sides. Tiny taking some hits, but willing to because of the mechanism and the Aegis.
Well, Yoki gets the stun down onto Cheshire Cat, but Mystic Flare not enough to bring him too low for the big old run into base and take him down. Tier 3 is falling, though. Resolution with a mech behind him, Wisp ready for the relocate save if it's even necessary. He's still got Aegis Immortal, so he's perfectly happy just sitting here and thumping away. Aloha Dance takes a dagger to the face. But PR, they're coming in from the sides. Axmo the Zeus, who's your target? Who do you go in for? Aloha Dance, Finger of Death, and Dichira will slice him down. Good, good prioritization there, but Epicenter, Axmo, four staffs up onto the ramp.
Nice big
Not heavy. Gonna get out of there, though. Static Storm, gonna hold him in place with the kinetic field, but three dead from PR. Cheshire Dichira, the last ones alive. Racks have fallen, and defending their bases is an impossibility at this point. You've got no AoE damage, you've got no stuns. Your slow from Nasal Goo is nice, but doesn't allow you to take anyone down.
Clean house, good damage from all sides here, and the only real casualty is that Wisp. Like, you're talking about the Skywrath is pretty low on the charts by comparison, and so bringing down the Wisp is a decent deal, but it doesn't excuse the loss of Rax. They didn't really have a choice, though. They were not even able to break the Aegis of the Immortal. They didn't force the Brew Split. Empire just had a huge strategic advantage from the onset of that fight. I like the four-staff flare from Zeus. Very quick dodge of the Mystic Flare, but it's just they have so much going for them for the side of Team Empire. And actually, they're going to just pursue on to no end.
God.
Jeez.
Bristleback gets obliterated. Dichira now on the run, popped his Mask of Madness. Yeah, that's what he's gone for, Mask of Madness. Try and get those hits and crits out as quickly as you possibly can. But with your entire team dead, it's time to call GG and say goodnight as Empire take game number two.
Damn. Dichira's build is okay for like being a Wisp Slayer. You pop the Mask of Madness BKB and you just jump the Wisp and it's great. You kill him, you kill the Skywrath really quickly if they don't go Scepter. But it's... You got nothing against that Tiny. You just really don't. And as soon as that BKB wears off, you're just hitting all the faster to get craggied over and over and over. It's just, it was a really tough game. And it broke down really quickly for the side of Power Rangers. They weren't able to really capitalize on the fact that the Bristleback got the Ultra Kill. And the movement from Empire, especially from Aloha Dance's IO, were just very impressive. I mean, you were talking about his levels, and it's because he was involved in most of the kills and always at the right position on the map.
Yeah, definitely. A huge contrast from the first game where his positioning was aggressive, to say the least, you know, getting into the enemy jungle and giving away a few kills here and there. But that's it for this series, guys. 1-1 is the final score. Everyone's rares will be returned as it's a draw in the end. But we'll be back in a couple of minutes with our second and final series of the night here for the D2CL European Division with Burden United against Balkan Bears. So stay tuned. Make sure to catch that as Blaze and I will be back in a couple of minutes.